This lecture is about neural networks. As you probably know, neural networks are extremely popular today. So we're going to talk about what really is a neural network. How does one construct such a network and use it to solve vision problems, in particular, visual detection and recognition problems? So let's take a look at some visual recognition problems. So let's say that your goal is to develop a system for detecting and recognizing faces. We know how to approach this problem. We've seen a few different approaches. One is the use of hard features followed by support vector machines for classifying images as being face images or non-face images. And we also talked about the use of principal component analysis to compute what are called eigenfaces, which can be used to both detect faces and recognize faces. So here's a problem for which we know how to develop fairly robust systems. Let's take a look at a more challenging problem, which is recognizing handwritten text. So here are various samples of handwritten text, and there's tremendous variability here. If you take a look at a single letter, such as the letter T right here, you see that it appears very differently from one person to the next. A lot of variability. And you can imagine that this is a very challenging recognition problem, but an important one in the context of optical character recognition. So how do we do this? How do you and I seem to be able to solve this problem with ease? And then let's take a look at another problem, which on the surface appears to be a very simple problem, very well defined. You want to develop a recognition system which has only one purpose, to recognize chairs. Now, all of these chairs that you're looking at have the same function, but very different forms, as a result of which they have very different appearances in images, very different three-dimensional geometries. How do we so easily recognize chairs? Again, a very complex mapping. So that brings us to the human brain. The human brain is simply remarkable, at least when it comes to developing very complex recognition systems that are qualitative in nature. We're not, as we've discussed before, very good at making precise quantitative measurements, but very good at making qualitative judgments. All that is being done by the brain. Needless to say, the brain is remarkable. It has an average weight of about 3.3 pounds, an average size of about 1,200 cubic centimeters. And what's remarkable is that although it accounts for only about 2% of the weight of a person, it consumes about 20% of the energy. And why is that the case? Because there's a lot of visual processing and other types of signal processing that's happening in the brain all the time. And so this energy is being used to process and transmit all kinds of signals, information. And the brain is nothing but a network of neurons. That's what's being shown right here. So there are roughly about 100 billion neurons, and these neurons are connected to each other, which accounts for about 100 trillion connections between these neurons. It is this very complex network that is able to allow us to do all the sophisticated perception tasks that we are able to perform on a daily basis, almost seamlessly. But the basic building block of the human brain is the neuron. So let's take a look at the neuron. So in the neuron you have, it's a single cell, you have a nucleus, and you have these dendrites. The dendrites actually receive signals from, for instance, other neurons, and then the signals come in, they're processed in some very simple way. That's what makes it very attractive. It's a very simple computation to produce an output. The output then travels through what's called the axon. And the axon could be very small, could be 1 millimeter in length, or it could be 1 meter in length. And so it travels through the axon and goes to the other end and goes to what are called synapses, the synaptic terminals right here. This is where one neuron makes a connection with another neuron. And all of the signaling and the transfer of information from one neuron to the other neuron is both electrical and chemical. It uses potassium ions and sodium ions. It's a very sophisticated, beautiful creation of nature. But at the end of the day, what it's doing is very, very simple when you think about a single neuron. And therefore, from a computational perspective, we can see this as a very simple computational module, which if you put together in large numbers, may be able to do something quite remarkable in terms of mapping inputs to outputs, even when the mapping is very complex. And that's really what a neural network does. So we're going to talk about how we construct an artificial neural network, and most importantly, given a task, how do we train such a network to perform that mapping? We're going to start by talking about a very simple type of neuron, which is called the perceptron. And we'll show that what a perceptron is really doing is behaving like a linear classifier. And if you create a network of perceptrons, could be a large network of perceptrons, what you end up with is a more complex linear classifier. Now, we know that linear classifiers are very useful, but perhaps can't solve all the problems that are of interest to us. And so in order to modify the perceptron to make it even more powerful, we look at what's called the activation function. The activation function takes you from the input to the output. That function in the case of a perceptron is a very simple function. It's a step function or the Heaviside function. But if we change this activation function even slightly to make it a continuous function, it has very attractive mathematical properties. In particular, we develop what's called a sigmoid activation function, and that allows us to create a sigmoid neuron, which we can put together to create a neural network as we know it today. So we'll talk about the neural network and the architecture of the neural network, and we'll show that the key challenge to neural networks is training the neural network. A reasonably sized neural network could have millions of parameters. So given training data, one of the goals is to find the parameters of the neural network that is going to perform the mapping of the input to the output with a high level of reliability and accuracy. For that, we use a technique called gradient descent. Gradient descent is an optimization tool that is extremely well known. Unfortunately for us, gradient descent can prove very, very expensive. For any fairly sized neural network, it turns out to be extremely computationally intensive to train the network using the traditional form of gradient descent. But there is a very clever innovation that was done in this context, which is called backpropagation. Backpropagation is a technique that is almost entirely based on the chain rule for derivatives and is able to speed up gradient descent significantly, and therefore allows us to train neural networks much faster than using just the traditional form of gradient descent. So we'll talk about backpropagation in great length and then show the use of neural networks in the context of different example applications.